Holy crap, guys, I'm about to finish reviewing an entire game series, in order and everything. Now, that's partly me bragging, but on the other hand, it's also me plugging my old videos.
I'll keep it brief here. First two Discworld games were well-written, funny, they had a nice full-screen interface, but they were held back by having a massive stiffy for Moon logic. I can't actually recommend you play them, but watching a Let's Play would be entirely worth it.
And considering it's the same development team for all three games, your hopes might not be placed that high. It is my great pleasure to tell you that Discworld Noir is worth playing if you can get it running, but I'll cover that a bit later. Story stuff is now!
The intro begins Moon with a long rambling entry about some silly incident involving the gods of the disc, written in the style of and possibly by the great Pratchett himself. It's funny, sure, but I suspect it's mostly a build-up to this absolutely terrible pun. After that, you get a sequence of a man running through the streets of Ankh-Morpork from the perspective of someone. Or maybe something, considering what happens to this gate. How on a two-in will this man escape the clutches of an abomination as ambulatory and relentless as... Oh, well, never mind. We fade to the man's grave and find out it belongs to Luton, the first private investigator on the disc. He's the main character, by the way. Yep, somebody chases down the guy you're playing as and murders him within the first minute. I mean, I don't like Moon logic either, but I wouldn't go this far to stop another game happening. Predictably, we then flashback to how Luton got into this fine mess. 1 week prior, a woman named Carlotta drops by Luton's office and asks him to investigate her lover, who's returned from his voyage abroad but hasn't come to see her. She'll pay handsomely, which is lucky considering Luton is counting stamps at this point. Not food stamps, actual mail stamps, the currency. It's a thing from this book, okay? He's flat out broke, is my point. Taking this case means he can keep a roof over his head and maybe even pay off his bar tab while he yearns for the love of a woman he once lost, so he goes out into the rainy city and I swear to God this game anticipated the creation of TV Tropes by 5 years. So, how does the game look and play? Well, they went from VGA pixels in the first game to hand-drawn animation in the second to finally land on pre-rendered backgrounds with a 3D model on top in the third. Now, we'd already had 3 Alone in the Darks, 2 Resident Evils and a Bioforge in a pear tree though, so that was nothing new at this point. It's just Luton that's rendered in 3D, oddly enough, and that's only when he's walking about. Everything else, including all the other characters, are pre-rendered. Animated sprites, basically, and a fairly low frame rate too. I mean, Grim Fandango rendered all its characters in 3D, despite that game coming out first, but hey, low frame rate equals a true cinematic feel, am I right, guys? And there's this sculptor fella who brings us that old pointy-click favourite, having to wait on a long-ass animation to finish before they'll reply to you.
You wouldn't happen to be Roland, would you?
Ah.
The pre-render stuff hasn't aged all that well, but the art style is consistent, it suits the tone of the game, and I found myself paying more attention to the writing and gameplay anyway. Like its predecessors, Discworld Noir has a full-screen interface with nothing but a big glowy thing for your mouse cursor. You left-click to do stuff to stuff, and right-click to get a sarcastic description of stuff. They also kept the overworld map for moving around the city, and double-clicking on an exit to warp straight through. In fact, interface-wise, it's pretty much the same engine as the previous games, but you'd never recognise it. There's one big innovation the game brought to the table, and that's the notebook. In the course of his investigation, Luton jots down important facts, clues, and a list of contacts related to each case. In addition to character-specific topics and a general banter button, the notebook pretty much gives you another dialogue tree. You pick a note to ask about, potentially unlocking even more notes and locations. Something else that's rather nifty is the ability to combine notes that you think are related in order to establish connections. Or it would be a nifty feature if the game properly told you that was an option and you didn't have to find out from a walkthrough. I know the point-and-click mantra is use everything on everything else, but I think we can all agree that was a little bit obfuscated. I'll save you some time. Click a clue once, then double-click on the one you want to combine it with. You're welcome. This feature was so good, the Blackwell legacy ripped it off. Unashamedly too, David Gilbert flat out admits it in the commentary, and I dare say his implementation was a bit easier to use. I really don't have a problem with stealing mechanics from other games, as long as the developers realise what makes that feature good, and not just because they think it'll sell more copies. The mere fact that Noir is playable without a walkthrough helps a lot. That's not to say it's easier exactly, more that the puzzles will be comprehensible to humans. Daft as it sounds for a Discworld game, you do actually feel like a detective, talking to people, getting clues, piecing them together. Most of it is dialogue and notebook based, with a few item puzzles thrown in where it makes sense. Apart from that, it's standard stuff. And compared to the put gem in mouth crap we've had to put up with in the past, that's fine. I could just say that Terry Pratchett had a hand in writing this, call the humour section of the review done and bugger off, but that wouldn't be fair. The game is funny the whole way through. As well as being the walking-talking PI trope, Luton apparently has a second career as a smart-arse sarcasm merchant whose witty banter doesn't distinguish friend from foe. Even better, the people he meets are either equally skilled or serve as perfect foils for his pithy comebacks and put-downs. Yes, he's a bit of an arse, but he knows he's an arse. Self-loving noir protagonist, remember? And it seems like some of his victims genuinely deserve it. This is Ankh-Morpork after all. Probably why Luton switches between a hard-boiled voice for people he thinks he's better than, and a softer voice for people he thinks can pound him into a puddle of blood and teeth. By the way, you might notice Luton's American accent is a little bit off. I'll solve the mystery for you now. His voice actor, Rob Brydon, is Welsh, and his natural accent bleeds through a bit. There you go, now 90% of you can go to Google to find out what the hell Welsh means. As if I could make this any clearer, the game relies not only on the lore of Discworld, but the tropes of the film noir genre. Eagle-eyed players will note references to The Maltese Falcon, Casablanca, and various other black and white movies starring a hat and a trench coat. The plot itself unveils in classic detective movie style. You start with a simple case, which gets more complicated, you get more cases, which also get more complicated, and then those increasingly complicated cases converge into a kaleidoscope of cruel complexity by the caper's convoluted conclusion. I'll be honest, that last line is just in there to try and make YouTube's auto-caption feature explode. You might have guessed this already, but the other big difference is that the game isn't based on an existing Discworld story, which I think freed up the developers to create their own experience without too much restriction. Not to mention it probably gave them ample parody material. Hell, you might not even need to be a Discworld fan to appreciate this. Mind you, Terry Pratchett's credit for causing far too much interference might render all those points moot.
I can't decide if it's a noir story set in Discworld, or if it's the Discworld universe turned noir. No, in fact, you know what it is? It's a noir story with Discworld characters as the actors. Hell of a production they're putting on, too.
They might be poking fun, but everything here screams noir. The soundtrack plays it completely straight, as if it were lifted from one of these films. Even the sounds that play when you get a new clue or location are noir as all hell. Combined with the art style and writing, it makes yet another layer on a very dark, moist cake. If nothing else, it provides an excuse for a pointy-click protagonist to comment on everything they're doing to nobody in particular.
This is easily the best Discworld game, and one I'm very happy to recommend to you. The irony being that it's also the hardest one to get running these days.
The first two games have ScumVM on their side. Install that and they'll run perfectly. Discworld Noir has no such help thanks to the old versions of Windows and DirectX it was made for. I found the most success with a combination of Windows compatibility settings, registry tweaks, and a program called D3D Windower, but I just happened to prefer playing in a window. Even then, the endgame cursor didn't match where my Windows mouse cursor was. There's several methods you can go looking for, but I think many people just go semi-nuclear and install it on a virtual machine. Whichever method you decide on, never press anything but New Game on the main menu screen. If you want to load or options, press F1 instead. I haven't had to work this hard to get a game running in quite a while. And while it didn't happen to me, I've heard that crashes can happen. Save early, save often applies here. Thankfully, there's an alternative to all this monkey business I just mentioned in the form of a PlayStation port. No Saturn release this time for some reason. Bear in mind it'll cost you more than your average PS1 title, and it's been stuffed onto a single CD compared to the original 3. So expect compressed videos and sound, some animations being cut down, plus it's a PC game on the PlayStation. A visual downgrade and extra load times are pretty much a given. It does support the mouse peripheral though, and as a pain-free way to play the damn thing, this wins by a mile. Unless you live outside Europe because it wasn't released anywhere else. Sorry. Doesn't even seem to be on PSN. So I'm left in an even more awkward position than I was with the first two games. Two games I would have recommended for the writing were it not for the gameplay. Now I have a game that I would recommend for both writing and gameplay, but I realise that not everyone is willing to spend the time I did getting it working, or the extra money for the console version that only came out in one region.
So I'm not going to demand you play it. It's a big ask, I realise that. It's just, you never think you're going to complete a Discworld game. It turns out the only one you want is just out of reach.
Play it again, Sam. You know what? No one's ever going to believe you said that.
You can't recall if the whiskey knocked you flat. If everything was a blur when you met her, all that you remember are the tunes of a vampire, a melody.